In this video, you're going to learn how to use the SwiftUI chart component, which lets you turn data like this into a beautiful chart like this. You can use a variety of different chart formats too, and it only takes 3 steps. Number 1, import the charts framework. Number 2, declare a chart component. And then lastly, loop through your data set and display each data point using a chart type of your choice. Now let's dive into Xcode and try it out. Okay, so here I've got an Xcode project, and all I've done so far is set up an initial struct and some dummy data. So let's take a look at this struct. It's called sleep data point, and it's got 2 properties. One is day, which is going to contain a string Monday, Tuesday, and so on and so forth, and hours, the number of hours slept on that day. Now I chose this type of data and these 2 properties just to keep it simple, because I think we can all understand the concept of each day and sleep. In the view, I've got a property called data, which is an array of these instances. And here I've just spaced it out so it's easy to read. So here you can see I've got from Monday to Sunday and a number of hours slept on that day. So in the view, I've just got a text element. Let's start by importing the charts framework. Easy. And then let's go into the view. We're going to get rid of this and we're going to create a chart component. Now open up a pair of curly brackets, and in here, we're just going to loop through this data array. So let's use a for each. We're going to pass in the data and we are going to loop it through it. Now for each instance inside that data, we are going to decide how we want to show that chart. If you get an error like this, make sure that your structure conforms to identifiable, because we're gonna loop through it. Let's give it an ID so that it can differentiate between each data point. Okay, so that's gonna get rid of that error. Now there are several options depending on what kind of chart you wanna show. Right now, I'll just show you a simple bar chart. So we're gonna use something called a bar mark. Here, there are also several different initializers you can use. I'm gonna use this one XY. I'll show you some documentation for what some of the other things are. Now this takes along the x-axis a plottable value, and then on the y-axis, the vertical axis, also a plottable value. So you have to decide based on your data what you want to go across the x-axis and the y-axis. So for us, let's say we want the days plotted horizontally and the number of hours plotted vertically. So what you can do is you can say plottable value dot, and then you can create a value using this. So it takes 2 parameters. One is a label. So let's call this the day. And where does it get its value? The value is in the day property, right? So we're going to use this parameter D, and we're going to specify the day. So that's going to go along the x-axis. Now, if you don't want to type out so much stuff, you can simply hit dot and choose value. And let's along the y-axis, let's go hours. And the data, the actual data, is in the hours property. All right, so let's get rid of that. Let me just space this out so it's a little easier to see. All right, so it looks something like that. And you get this chart just like that. So each time it loops through the data, it is creating one of these bar marks. Now keep in mind, this also groups the data as well. So let's say that for Monday, I had 2 data points. Like that. And let's say I slept 6 hours on Monday and then another 2 hours. You can see that it doesn't add another Monday to the x-axis. It actually groups it together. And now this is 8. You can see the scale goes up to 10 because Wednesday was 10. Now what we can do, let me show you a couple of other things you can do. So let's add some padding first of all to make it look just a little bit nicer. Very quickly, I want to say that if you don't want a bar chart, you can very easily change this bar mark to a different type of chart marker. And many of them also accept an X and a Y as an initializer. So very easily, for example, I can change bar mark to point mark. You would have kind of like a scatter plot graph. You can change it to line mark. You'd get a line graph. Or perhaps you might want an area graph, which is kind of like a line graph just colored underneath. And this part right here, I think, is due to our data right here, us having 2 pieces of data on Monday I don't think it that plays very nicely with the area chart. All right, there you go. So if you want an area chart, perhaps you don't have that type of data. But if you look at the documentation, you're going to see there are different types of markers you can use. Rule mark and rectangle mark are two that we haven't looked at because I think those require a little bit more configuration. Let's go back to, let's undo. So I have that data point again. Let's go back to the bar chart because I'm going to show you a couple of customizations that you can do to it. For example, if you want to add a label to it, you can add what's called an annotation. Okay, so we are going to add a text element, and we are going to specify, let's say, the number of hours, right, as a text element. And by default, it positions it on top right there. But notice, however, on Monday, right, since we have two segments, 6 and 2, it's only showing the 2. And the reason is because that 2 segment is on top of the 6 segment, and that little chunk is probably covering the 6th label, and it's only showing the 2 labels. So if you wanted a total for Monday, you would probably have to do some calculations here, because by passing in D, we are only getting like one sliver or one instance of that sleep data. You're going to have to calculate, probably grab all of the Mondays in that data set and add it together to show that total. What we can try to do instead is actually change the position of this annotation. So there are several parameters. Let's use overlay. And what that does is actually put the number on the segment itself. So now you can see that this segment is 6 and that is 2, but there is no color differentiation. So it's kind of hard to see, right? Because Monday actually has 2 segments in it. So if we wanted to draw a distinction between the 2 segments, we need to distinguish them in the data. So let's add another dimension to our data. Right now, we only have 2 dimensions, day and hours, right? So let's add a third dimension and call it type. So this one is a string. Let's call it the type of sleep it is. So nighttime sleep or nap, perhaps, or something else. So by default, it's going to be night. And let's say for this data point, this was actually a nap. Okay, and then in here, now you can color the segments depending on the type. Let's add another modifier to the bar mark. Notice that I'm adding these modifiers to the bar mark and not the chart. So let's say that we want to color the foreground style and we want to color it by a certain dimension of the data. So again, it's plottable value. We're going to hit dot value, and the label, we're going to use type, and type is specified by our type property. All right, so now you can see that it's a different segment. Let's change the foreground color to white. And there we go. And you can see actually a legend has also appeared down here now that there are several colors. Let's add one more to Monday. Let's say Friday, I had 1 hour of sleep. So I needed to take, first of all, a nap, as well as, let's say I accidentally fell asleep. Has that ever happened to you where you're so tired, you just fall asleep when you didn't intend to? So now we have 3 different data types, right? And the legend updates by itself as well. Now there's a lot of customizations that you can do to charts. So far, we've been adding these modifiers to the mark or the segment itself, but there are also modifiers that you can apply to the chart component. So for example, if you just type in chart, autocomplete will show you all of these different things that you can do. So for example, if we do scale range, this one, you can add some padding to the top and the bottom. And you can see how there's padding at the top and padding at the bottom now. So today we've gone through some basics about how to add a SwiftUI chart to your app. You might have noticed that there's no pie chart option. Well, good news. In iOS 17, it will include pie charts and donut charts. We're going to cover that next week. In the meantime, however, if you're new to iOS app development, definitely check out our 3-hour masterclass on SwiftUI, where you're going to build your first app no experience required. All right, thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.